Hi viewers, welcome back. This is Literary Goa, the program that looks at books and authors from Goa. Today we have with us Pantaleon Fernandez. He is an engineer turned author of all these books. 6 books published and 2 on their way, correct Pantaleon?
Yes, 2 on the way meaning looking for some method of publishing the 2 books because they're children's books.
Yeah.
And children's books are very difficult to...
We'll come to that later, but the bulk of your books are coffee table books on Goa.
Yes, 3 books are coffee table books. There are another 2 coffee table books coming up. Their work is half done.
So the latest you have is Goa Rare Portraits. Could you introduce the book to us?
Yeah, Goa Rare Portraits, basically what I mean by rare portraits is the photographs shown here are not very easy to come by because the landscape is very rapidly changing in our villages. So, I have come across these pictures, you know, out of the blue. I haven't planned for them. Whenever I went for some kind of my village work, I saw these things happening and I captured them. And if you tell me to go and recapture them, it may not be possible. So, that's why I call them rare. And this book was not planned. I met with an accident last year. And I was on wheelchair for 5 months. So that time in my mind, all the photographs from my spectrum came into my mind and formed itself into a kind of a book. So I sat on my computer during that time and I collected them. I wrote the captions and that's how the book came about.
Wow, interesting story. But which are your favorite images from this book?
The cover is a favorite because... This lady is from Ambauli,
Kepe.
And I managed to catch her like this. She is not, none of my pictures are rehearsed.
Yeah.
Or
posed.
Or posed or dressed.
Dressed.
A kind of choreographed or whatever. These are pictures that I have seen and I have photographed. I have not told them to dress. Now, why is she dressed here? Is because there was a mela, there was a tribal festival. She's obviously a tribal and there was a tribal festival. The backdrop of the mall is there.
Yeah.
She was there. I just told her I want to photograph you. And she spontaneously, I said, I like your jewelry. I looked at it. She put her finger.
I see.
And there and that's the photograph. So that's one of my favorite photographs. That's why it is made to the cover.
And the point you're making is that Goa is changing very fast. And if we don't capture these images, we are going to lose even the memories. Is that correct?
Yes, because whenever I speak about any event or any history of the event, if I go to a festival and I say, what is the origin? Nobody knows. They say, I'm khabar na. Zantele khabar ha. Zantele koi aadre. Zantele gele. So you ask the parents, they say the same thing. Zantele khabar ha, saam khabar na. So actually, a lot of things are lost. You come across weird customs happening in the interiors of Goa.
Yeah.
You can't make out why they are happening because people don't know. Simply, they're just repeating what is there. That they know that they have to do this and they have to do X, Y, Z. They don't know why they're doing it.
So, you're saying that Goa is not a very studied or understood place in spite of having high literacy, early printing presses, quite an active media. We are not enough studied.
Whatever you have mentioned, literacy, media and the printing press was not there. It had not penetrated into the grassroots levels. It is there in the cities, the history is written. I am talking about, my books are talking mostly about the deep percolate, the deep level, you know, underground level, where grassroots level, where no pressman has ever come before. Because these heroes of mine and heroines of mine in this book have probably for the first time being shown in the book.
See.
Or in the press. When I used to do a series of articles for the Times of India some years back, I used to bring out these characters onto the front page of the Times of India, and that was probably the first time anybody has actually taken them up.
Acknowledge that they exist, that this diversity is
there.
Yeah,
and what are their uniqueness, what are their qualities, what are their things that we can actually, you know, learn from them, the whatever it is. So, so whatever you mentioned is there in the cities. But
they're not enough probably, no?
That depends who writes it, whether they're covering now. If there's a some leaders, freedom fighters, they have been written about, they have been covered. But there are also freedom fighters, you know, from the Dangar community who have been doing very hard work. You know, these as children, these freedom fighters, these people who are old now, they have been leading the freedom fighters into the forest. They were the guides. But most of them are not mentioned as freedom fighters. These people have actually taken the risk. They have been hammered, they have been captured, beaten to show the way, to show them the where, but they haven't, and they're not even listed as freedom fighters.
So given your engineering background, how did you get involved in understanding Goa?
Engineering was by kind of a default system where in Goa at my time you had to be an engineer or doctor or some other so-called respectable occupation. So so that's how I went into engineering. So, but I did enjoy it when I came out of the day I finished my exam. The next day I started working and I started enjoying it immensely.
Civil.
Because it was civil, and civil engineering we see everywhere. And when I used to come to college in Panjim, I used to see the bridges being built. At the time a couple of them were being built. So everything was happening live in front of my eyes. Construction was happening all the time. It was happening. So it was an interesting subject compared to the 11th, 12th where everything is abstract. Nothing is actually visible. So I did enjoy it to a certain extent. I enjoyed talking to my workers. I used to have a healthy relationship with my workers. I learned Hindi very well. I was very poor. I learned it. It was a good experience. But then I started seeing the destruction of the environment with construction. Like I used to go and cut trees.
This is 90s?
This is in the early 90s.
Early 90s.
I would go and cut trees because every time I wanted a shuttering to be done, I would ask someone to sell me a tree in the neighborhood and get it cut, of course, with proper permissions. That time it was pure business. There were too many trees. In my own property, there were trees. So it was okay. I was doing that. For frames, I needed teak wood. So we needed a lot of trees. So then slowly, you know, this thing started percolating into me. Then I also developed my own land, which was 4,000. I lived in a 4,000 square meter land in Benavli with a nice house. So I developed it because my father found it a bit difficult to restore the house because it was quite a prohibitive amount. So I said, I'll step in and I'll develop it. I did develop, and because of that, I've destroyed the environment then, that time. I didn't realize it that time. I was very young. I was fresh out of college. Then I saw the destruction happening of the groundwater level due to septic tanks, due to the people, the way they do not manage garbage, the way everything is, you know, littered around. So all these things started bothering me. And the final tipping point came when you were forced to make a payment, unofficial payment, at any stage of your, you know, the machinery where you have to get the plans approved.
I see.
You have to get them passed. So that I thought, if everything is good, I mean, if things are not good, people do demand, that is a different issue. But if everything is fine, also you've got to pay. And so,
if this is development, it can't be so costly now in that sense.
Yes. So that finally, that was the final straw. So I said, let me look at other avenues. And I was always good at my camera. In my college, I did the magazine. I did the photography for the magazine. I did the main articles for the magazine. I was a magazine secretary, magazine editor for 2 years. And people would appreciate those things. So I saw that I could, you know, step into those shoes as a photographer, as a writer. So what I did was I started reading about writing. I started reading other people's writings, features.
I
attended a course. One of them was yours, as you know. I attended many short-term courses at ICG, International Center.
I
got books on journalism. In fact, I started writing medals in the Navin Times. And with the money that I collected from there, I started buying books.
I see.
So my book on photography I bought that time. And I use that book, even today I use it sometimes because it's a basic photography book. So that book I have, it's written there from my pen, 1998 or something, or 1995.
Very interesting story, but I want to come back to your books. Introduce this one to us.
So, okay. Now, one of the,
maybe your favorite pictures, or
as you open the book, you enter Goa. This is
where?
This is generic Goa, no?
But
Goa
where?
Is full of, this is in Agonda.
Agonda.
Yeah, you can, I know
coconut
every picture,
trees, coconut
every
trees.
Picture where it is collected all in my head.
Coconut
yeah,
trees.
So this is, we enter Goa here. And then, of course, I have a nice forward by Victor Anjelbab. was good enough.
Victor Angel Ribeiro, the non-Nigerian writer and novelist
and he, man of many roles. In spite of being busy, he said he's glad to do it because he said he appreciates my work. So that was a good
compliment.
Yes. Now, this one of my favorite photographs would be this. This is a Dalo happening in the village of Paroda. Now, why it is very rare, why it is a favorite? Because this is probably, you can see this is in on the Mand.
The Mand is a traditional stage of the Gowda community.
Stage, traditional space where the community is, I wouldn't say Gowda, because there is also a Mand in Shandor of the Kshatriya community.
Okay, okay.
So it's a sacred space of the villages.
Okay.
Now here, these people are on the Mand, the lamp is lit here.
Yeah.
That lamp is a symbol, that they light the lamp first to awaken the Mand actually. And here they are in their original dresses, they are dancing here. And so I happened to be there, and today you cannot get them to do this because the Mand is no longer active.
I see.
And probably this is one of the last times that I I happened to be there, and I happened to catch them at their Mand with the lamp lit. So this is the Dalo that is now. Dalo Mands are very, very active, but they are all Hindu Dalo Mands.
Yeah.
Christian Dalo Mands are almost non-existent for various reasons. So this is one of the last. Whenever I ask them, are you all having this function again? They say we'll try, and finally don't have it. So this is the first picture, because in a way they pay tributes to the creator, and they dance. So this is, and probably I don't think this will happen again. So that has come first here, and it's one of my favorites. Then another favorite would be here.
What Where is this? Which
what
part
has happened
of Goa?
Is this to the man to the right. He's a toddy tapper. Now I had gone to Bogmalo to do my study of my village.
Outside Daboni, and outside Vasco.
Yeah, and I found some coconut trees there with this Daboni. Daboni are the traditional earthenware vessels to collect toddy from the tree. I saw them down there, and I knew that there are some toddy tappers here. So I met Mr. Fulgencio. He's a senior person, who very knowledgeable senior person. So he said, there is one toddy tapper here who can who you can talk to. And he just called for somebody, and here he came here.
It's dying, no, the profession. Many of these traditional professions
are. Yeah, that is handled in my another book. Anyway, here, so what I'm saying is, he came here, and when I photographed him, Mr. Fulgencio told him, says, you will now be remembered forever.
I see.
You probably, I mean, you can. You
What's
can
his
see
age?
His age may be in his 80s that time.
My goodness, climbing trees?
No. He hasn't been climbing trees.
Okay.
He has retired.
Okay.
But he did come.
Okay, and demonstrated the process.
And he simply, I mean, you can see him wearing the kasti with that he didn't wear for me. But he already was
I
wearing.
I see.
Okay, you can, that he was already wearing that kasti. He simply collected his tools and he posed there.
Yeah.
Now, the thing is, he was told that this photograph will make him immortal. When the book was published, I did go to meet him with
I
the
see.
Book. He had already passed away.
Oh, gosh.
And but he is immortal, no? He's alive, he's happy, he's smiling.
True.
Okay, then the next photograph is of a coconut plucker.
Yeah.
Now, what happened was, I was going to another village with a friend, and I saw one cyclist passing us by very fast. So I told my friend, just stop, I want to see that cyclist. Now the cyclist was carrying a certain kind of, they're called vaye or aye. They are, you know, the fibers which are ripped out of a palm leaf.
Okay.
These are then used to tie the pod of the toddy pod.
Okay.
They are also used for various other reasons. So I saw that, I identified him as one of the in the profession, and I chased him. And when we stopped him, he was, why are you stopping me? I said, is that the vaye? The minute I called that out in the correct name, he connected with me. He said, yes. Yeah. How do you know? I said, I know, because we are we had coconut plantation we used to pluck. So I said, do you pluck now? He said, yes. I said, can you demonstrate? And he said, yes, sure. And he came and he demonstrated, and I just clicked some photographs. So this is another photo. So again, you cannot get these people in these costumes again. He is gone. He, I don't know whether he'll be, he just did it for me, I don't know why. So like that, these things go on, then there is this fisherman.
The
again.
Rampon.
Yes.
The Rampon. Where, which beach?
This is in Benavli. Then
still pulled? In how many beaches of Goa would the Rampon be
Rampon
pulled?
Is still happening frequently in Salset.
Salset.
Plus it happens in Kankon. But Kankon, they are the other kind of, they are called Gabit. They are different community. These are the Kharvi.
Yeah.
And whereas those are the... garbage. Now, I also am fortunate to have you know, contextualize the images with writings by people like Wendell Rodriguez. Okay. Story is written. Wendell has kind of, you know, talked about the costume that I'm showing.
I see.
Completely. So these are the original costumes that are coming through of the villages, and Wendell has kind of contextualized them. So he's
also quite deep into understanding Goa. And
he understands as a costume designer. Yeah. He knows. Yeah. Costumes very, very. Yeah. Deeply. Like here, like this photograph is a kind of, you know, connecting the past and the present and the. So she's wearing a costume which is known as the daintily. She is wearing a sari with a, which is fastened with a daintily. It's
not,
a knot.
Not.
And there's no blouse underneath.
Yeah.
So this was their costume. Now she is standing next to the grinding stone, which is in her time it has been discarded.
I see.
Now you can see that it discarded as a mud day.
I see.
So that age, her age, the age of this grinding stone is probably similar. Plus the age of the background is mud here. Oh. Mud wall. These are also being discarded. If you go back to the villages now, you see them replaced by laterite walls.
Okay. Very interesting. But I just want to jump ahead to your next book, because we have so much to cover here. And this is called The Parish Churches of Goa.
Yes.
Of course, it's by Giuseppe Lorenzo, who is now in Europe. We'll miss him. But the point is that all the photographs here are yours.
Yeah. How many? This book is actually the beginning point of my foray into books.
Which year?
This was probably in 2003-04.
This is a new edition, probably the first edition, does it mention?
This is saying 2011, yeah, this is a new
edition. This is a new edition.
Yeah. So I think it was somewhere in the four or five.
I see.
That Jose approached me, and that time I had already started my little bit of photography.
Yeah, yeah.
So he approached me and he said, I have this project in mind, are you game? So the work entailed going to every village. That immediately excited me, because somehow instinctively I have love for villages.
This is not difficult work, but it is tough work. You have to travel a lot spend a lot of time.
It is also difficult, because imagine we are starting from Margaon.
Yeah.
We are going to Perne.
Yeah.
And we are going by bike, because that time I think neither of us had a car.
I see.
So we going by bike so far is not
right.
Very easy.
Right.
And another point is that, you know, most people have told me that these photographs look very live. This is one of the first books probably in Goa run on a digital camera.
I see.
So what happened was, you know, the camera I had,
yeah,
could on a TIFF format capture only one photograph. Can you imagine?
Only one photograph?
Yeah.
Because then the memory would get filled up.
Yeah. And if it is in TIFF format.
In TIFF.
TIFF is uncompressed format.
Yeah.
So imagine going from Benavale to Perne and doing one search and going back.
You can't download it?
Download it on what?
Okay.
On a laptop. We didn't have a laptop. So we would do that, and coming back all the way again, so it is hard work.
It also required money because
you required a lot of petrol. We had
true,
to spend.
True.
So it started like that. Then I upgraded. I bought another fat card. It was almost
okay.
Like, it was a hard drive.
32 GB.
No. It was not 32 GB. 32 GB was not even the computer was not 32 GB that time. So this was a card which was a hard disk.
Yeah.
It had many pins. I don't know what it was called. So I got that. I bought that. And then we could do more.
I see.
That gave me my break. What happened was, after the churches,
yeah,
I also started photographing the other things that I saw. If I saw an interesting tree, I would photograph
okay.
that. I would see a chapel, I would photograph that. Because I used to ride,
yeah,
mostly. So I would stop and I would photograph.
Yeah.
So I would. So that started my visit around Goa. Before that, the Goa I knew was very limited. So this book has started my adventures with books, actually. So then when this book was published, everybody appreciated it. So I
yeah.
said, yes, I could go into photography more deeply.
It was a team effort with Jose, basically Jose's work.
Yeah,
of
it was Jose's idea completely.
Yeah.
He approached me only for the photographs.
So you are both classmates from Loyola's Margao?
Yeah, we are classmates from school in Loyola High School.
Margao. Which year of?
We passed out in 82.
82.
So it was for the before that, some 5-6 years prior, we were classmates. We were also incidentally good friends, because we both like to read a lot.
Anyone inspired you in your school days to read?
Inspired in the sense, you know, my parents always saw that there were books at home. Like there was one ship which had come when I was very small in the
Logos,
primary.
Logos.
Primary. That was
MV Logos.
I wouldn't know the name, but I remember the ship.
Yeah.
Full of books.
Full of books.
And they took
reasonably
all of
priced.
Us,
reasonably priced.
Yeah, they took us all to my MPT. I saw huge ships there.
Yeah.
And we were taken on that book. I had my first
launch.
Computer there,
yeah,
where some robot was talking. That my image is still firmly in my mind. And they picked up a whole lot of books.
I see.
especially for children. So those books fired my imagination. I used to like to read it. Then, so they are primarily responsible for these books. Then the library in the school was well equipped, and I used to take one book at home every day, read it and return it the next day.
I see.
A full book.
I see.
Like mostly Hardy Boys, Annette Blyton's. Annette Blyton's books I loved reading. So, but I would read a full book.
In those times, yeah, all of us. That was our staple diet.
Yeah, there was no computer, there was no television, there was nothing. You come home from school, what do you do besides the books?
Yeah.
You went to play out a bit later. We played out a lot outdoors, but later because of the sun and other children had to be free too. So that was how my love for books started.
You have written some children's books also, some of which are published and some of which are waiting to be.
Yes, one has been published.
Yeah.
Now the one which is published is Once Upon a Time in Goa. Now what has happened is, I heard people saying that, you know, there are a lot of, I used to write a lot, so I wrote about another children's book writer and I compared her to Annette Blyton. And I heard a lot of issues saying that, who's Annette Blyton, why Annette Blyton, we don't even know what she's talking about, some scones and goblins and, so I said, that's true. So I said, let me start also writing something for children where they will understand the language, they'll understand what I'm talking about, the villains, the monsters, etc. So I went into my childhood and these are stories that are crafted from actual incidences from my childhood. So these have got, these are illustrated by Angela
Ferrau.
So these talk about the chickens which were hatched, which were very, you know, momentous occasions for us in a house, how the chickens were hatched.
Typical Goan childhood from the 70s.
Yeah, how
or
the
80s.
Eagle would come and snatch away the chickens and how we would with our catapult shoot them down.
I see.
So these things have become a story. Then the pigs, how the pigs would litter and the jackals would come for the you know, the piglets, and how my father used to go out with a gun to shoot away, chase away the jackals. So all these have become stories, and they are true stories. I mean, they are based on facts.
Yeah, what we saw in our lifetime, in our childhood.
Yes, then there is a cock without his tail because a wildcat has come and snatched it off.
Really?
And that is another story, and that cock I have got is photograph if anybody wants to
see
it. So that is another story. Then we used to go to hunt for tortoise, you know, outside. With our, we had a kind of a spear.
Yeah.
We would just poke it in the heaps of leaves. And if you hit a turtle, you would get a sound, tok, 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 then you would get it out.
I see.
So this was another story is there mentioned. So
those days were very adventurous to grow up in Goa.
Yeah. So this is the book based on those things. But unfortunately, though it is an attractive looking book, children are very much attracted. Right from very small children to little grown up children, they are attracted. But I find that the parents are not responding, they are not very encouraging. So the shift has happened. Parents in my time wanted children to read. Parents now, they may want them to read, but they do not give them the books. They think that reading may be academic books. But
waste of time, waste of money, waste of space.
Yes,
I mean, they look at it quite negatively.
But the same parents would do not hesitate spending that same money on popcorn or on hamburgers.
Okay, to be unfair, can you tell us about the remaining books in a few minutes?
Yeah, so the next book that I thought I would do for children is about educating them about occupation. So this is a book that I did, which is a bilingual book, Konkani and English, where, you know, the idea was the children who speak Konkani study Konkani would be able to read the English version and be smart in English and the vice versa.
Yeah.
So it had illustration. Then it's a book that educates children on the village occupations. So it's a book that I thought would help children, but I have kind of burnt my fingers here, so I can't publish it on my own. So I'm looking for some grant or some publisher to come in, but so far it's difficult because color books, hardcover books, children's books are expensive.
Cost is pushed up.
Yeah, and you can't sell it for a very cheap rate in the market. So this is one book that is waiting for somebody to kind of help. This is another book that I did. This is a black and white book, but again, children's book. The stories are all having morals, you know, they are talking about
animal stories.
They're talking about how to loving of animals and garbage in the forest and the deforestation, how we can actually avoid all these things. This is another book that is waiting to be published. Then
this is interesting. 100 Goan experiences.
100 Goan experiences.
Think you sold the most number of copies of this.
Yeah, I sold 13,500 copies of this book.
And that's quite a big number for a small Goa.
Yes, and the paradigm shift came from the decision came to actually shift my profession was this book.
Wow.
because after doing Parish Churches of Goa, I had the photographs, so I made a list of what could be done. This title just struck me.
And
so
what is 100 Goan experiences here?
100 Goan experiences are any Goan. Yeah. This was basically not for a tourist.
Okay.
It's for Goans, because most Goans did not know Goa at all.
They don't know their own state. Yeah.
They
yeah.
just know the their village and the village of their mother, and when they yeah. married, the village of their wife.
Yeah.
That's it. They don't know anything else. Mostly, this is generally.
Yeah, we don't travel even within the small state.
Yeah. So this book is supposed to take the Goans out of their altar and take them exploring some rarer known spots like temple ruins in Vichundre or Brahma Karmali temple of say Brahma. Or seeing where these candy crafts are made in Konkoli.
In Konkoli. Lake away.
Wooden toys. Then some rarer museums of vehicles which are there, which are people hardly know. The museum of aviation museum.
Yeah.
Which is the only one in Asia or something like that.
Yeah.
So this rarer features are here. Say the British cemetery, some rare waterfalls.
Wow.
Savre waterfall. That time when this book was done in around 2005, most people were not aware of so many of these features.
Which now they get a little bit more written about, no?
Yeah, now people were using it I was working as a journalist. People were using this book as a guide sometimes to, get stories.
I see.
Okay, there is an issue with stories, then they can get a story, you just go through, take a subject and make a story. So this book has been the main book to shift me from and when I got this response, then I said, yeah, let me stick to this.
And these last two, Goa Remembered and
Goa Remembered, is a book that again I said I've got so many photographs, so I kind of opened them up into a bigger
traditional Goa?
Bigger format. This book is a shortcut to Goan culture, half an hour shortcut. You go through the whole book, you read the forward, Dr. Maria Arora Kuto. Go through the book, you know culture very fast, Goan culture in a short while.
Yeah.
So it talks about some celebrations, some work culture, some landscapes. It's a kind of a mixed bag.
Stained glass, one of the very few stained glasses at Pilar.
Pilar, yes, here it is.
We don't have much stained glass in Goa for some reason.
Yes, so no. this is very stunning. So these are the, and this book again, I had the guts to print 2000. This is my first coffee table book. I went ahead and I did 2000.
It's costly and risky, no?
Yeah, but what I did was I again raised the funds by selling the. Whenever I showed the dummy to somebody, they were exclaiming, and I said, then can you buy it?
Yeah,
buy
yeah.
a copy? Would you like a copy? And I was giving a 50% off. Or the offer was.
Pre publication.
Yeah, offer was take two for the price of one.
Okay.
And I sold enough and I got it done.
And last?
This, of course, was kind of the. It has documented a lot of occupations. It has documented 50 occupations, and like the first one which I mentioned here is the Gano. This is a
traditional extraction oil
of extraction
oil mill. Yeah.
By a wooden Gano. So
where?
This is in Agonda.
Still running?
It is still running.
Wow.
Yeah. And then there is this cloth weaver who is now paralyzed, and I went to meet him with a friend of mine who was trying to convince him to restart. And we will buy whatever you make.
I see.
But he is reluctant because there are no carpenters to repair the handloom. So this is the last photographs I have got of him.
Of course.
Then the Tariya Mama.
Where?
This is in Sal, River Sal.
Sal.
Sorry, village of Sal in Benavle.
Sal.
In Bichuli. Then we have the Poder is of course common. Salt pens
salt.
Are common.
But dying out again.
Yeah, this is God. This man, very few people have seen the making of the
Jaggery.
Jaggery,
Goan style.
Raw sugar, yeah.
Where?
This was in somewhere on the Kankon Road.
Wow.
Then the Madache God, which is actually extinct. This is Madache Soro. This is Thodi Tepo. He is also paralyzed.
It's amazing. I mean, the collection that you put down, and I hope that more people can encounter your books and get to know of them. We've already done through this small effort. Here's wishing you all the best, Panthalya. Thank you so much for spending your time with us, and looking forward to see many more books, not just eight.
Thank
from
you.
Your pen.
Thank
Thanks.
You. I am having many books in the pipeline, so I hope they do birth. And
they will, definitely. All the best.
Thank you.